A warm welcome to all for today's session on biaxial minerals. We have already discussed about the uniaxial minerals and its interference figure and optic sign determination. Today, we're going to discuss about the biaxial minerals, its comparison with isotropic uniaxial minerals, and also in the biaxial indicators, we are covering in detail the optic axial plane, optic normal, and optic axis. Then we'll be seeing the parts of the biaxial interference figure and how do you able to identify the optic sign based on the optical indicators. This is what we have seen in the last class, where we have seen the minerals can be classified based on the crystal system and it has a relationship with the optical properties also. So based on the optical properties, the crystal systems can be classified broadly into isotropic and anisotropic, where isometric system, which is characterizing the isotropic minerals, and all other systems which constitute the anisotropic minerals, which can be further divided into a second part that is called as anisotropic, can be further classified as uniaxial and biaxial. We're going to see what is an optical indicatrix. This is what the definition of indicatrix states, where you can see that optical indicatrix is a geometric figure that shows the index of refraction and vibration direction for light passing in any direction through a material is called optical indicatrix. So in the case of this classification where isotropic, uniaxial, and biaxial, we are going to see in the next slide how the indicatrix of this group of minerals will look like. So as we have seen, it's based on the refractive indices of the mineral. Isotropic minerals are characterized by one RI, so the indicatrix will look like a sphere. In the case of uniaxial minerals, it is characterized by two RI, and the indicatrix of a uniaxial mineral is going to be a biaxial ellipsoid with the refractive indices of the biaxial ellipsoid would be of N epsilon and N omega, respective to the two axes based on NE and NO. And the third one, that is a biaxial mineral, it has got three RIs, which is normally represented as N alpha, N beta, and N gamma, where you can see that, the indicatrix is going to be looking like a triaxial ellipsoid. Okay, so based on the classification, based on optics, we can see that isotropic minerals has got one RI, the indicatrix is a sphere. Uniaxial is having two RI, the indicatrix is a biaxial ellipsoid, and biaxial minerals are having three RIs, and the indicatrix will be a triaxial ellipsoid. Let's see it once again with some diagrams to make the concept clear. In the isotropic indicatrix, you have got only one RI. So if you plot that, you can see that the indicatrix of isotropic minerals will look like a sphere. So if you take sections of that indicatrix, each section will be a circular section. So if somebody is asking you an optic axis or how many optic axes is present in an isotropic mineral, normally we say optic axis is perpendicular to the circular section. So it will be having infinite number, or we can say it doesn't have two or more refractive indices. So the birefringence is going to be zero. Coming to uniaxial indicatrix, this we have seen in our last lecture, where we have seen that quartz is an example of a uniaxial positive mineral, calcite is an example of a uniaxial negative mineral. But the indicatrix is a reflection of the refractive indices of those minerals in the E direction or E-ray vibration direction and O-ray vibration direction. So when you see the indicatrix, it is going to be something like this. It has got two axes. It's an ellipsoid with two axes. So one axis is going to be parallel to E-ray vibration direction represented as N epsilon, and the other one is going to be parallel to the horizontal vibration direction that is going to be N omega. So in case, we have seen that based on the indicatrix, if you want to identify the optic sign of a mineral, if N epsilon value is going to be greater than N omega, we can say it's a uniaxial positive. And if it is going to be the other way, where N omega is going to be greater than N epsilon, that particular mineral is going to be uniaxial negative. So I hope you understood these two concepts clear. let's go back to the third one, which we are going to discuss today. That is the biaxial integrators. So it is typically called as a triaxial ellipsoid because it has got three axes, because it has got three refractive indices. So we can see in the case of biaxial, we have already seen that biaxial minerals are belonging to these three systems, that is orthorhombic, monoclinic, and triclinic. And all three systems are characterized by three axes are of different length. That is A, not equal to B, not equal to C. But in the case of indicatrix, when you look at it, we can see that the N alpha, N beta, and N gamma are the respective indicatrix or respective refractive indices of a biaxial mineral that will constitute to form an ellipsoid with having three axes. So we will see angles like this way, N alpha and N gamma sections will be there, N beta, N gamma sections will be there, and N alpha and N beta section will be there. It's something like a potato, where if you want to compare with some of the discussion we have, like a cucumber, orange, etc. for uniaxial, it is something like a triaxial ellipsoid with three axes, respective of the X vibration direction, Y vibration direction, and Z vibration direction. So you can see that a potato has three perpendicular axes of different length. Thus, we need three different arrays to describe the biaxial mineral. That is, X direction is characterized by N alpha, Y direction is characterized by N beta, that is the intermediate. And we will see in the next slide that this is the N beta is going to be the radius of the circular section, and NZ is the highest refractive indices, that is N gamma. Okay, so in the case of orthorhombic, remember this orthorhombic, monoclinic, and triclinic has got A, B, C as the crystallographic axis, where A not equal to B not equal to C. But over here, how it is going to be relating with the optical vibration directions, where you can see that in orthorhombic, X, Y, Z is going to be parallel to the crystallographic axis. And in the case of monoclinic, only one of the vibration directions coincide with the crystallographic axis. And in the case of triclinic, none of the indicatrix axes coincide with respect to the crystallographic axis. So this is one of the major concepts that you need to actually remember. Unlike the uniaxial, where the C axis was the one which represents the N epsilon, and the horizontal axis direction was the one which is parallel to the N omega. So if you look at this, these are the three examples of three system representative crystals and how the indicatrix is oriented. So this is an example of an orthorhombic system where you can see that X, Y, Z is going to be parallel to A, B, C. Not necessarily X is going to be parallel to A, Y is going to be B, and Z is going to be C. So it can be in any orientation, but it is going to be parallel to the crystallographic axis, that is A, B, C. So the indicator is going to be aligned parallel to the orthorhombic system crystallographic axis. But in the case of monoclinic and triclinic, there is a slight difference that you can see, where you can see Y axis is the one which is going to be parallel to the B axis. So you can see the indicator vibration direction is going to be parallel to B, but Z and X are not going to be parallel to C and A. So one of the vibration direction can be Y, it can be X, that can come in contact with that, and based on that, the respective vibration directions of monoclinic and triclinic will make an angle with respect to the crystallographic axis. But in the case of triclinic, that you can see that none of the indicatrix vibration directions are going to be parallel to the crystallographic axis. So if such kind of diagrams are given to you and you have been asked to identify which system this particular mineral belongs to, you can look at this closely and you will be able to make your conclusion that whether this belongs to the monoclinic system, triclinic system, or orthorhombic system. Look at this. This is a crystal of olivine where we can see that A is parallel to Z, B is parallel to X, and C is parallel to Y, where we can see that this is going to be representing olivine. Identify the crystal system of olivine and rhodite based on the diagram. So we have seen the previous diagram. If it is going to be parallel to all three axes, then that belongs to orthorhombic system. And you very well know that olivine belongs to orthorhombic system. In the case of monoclinic system, where you can see one of the axes is going to be parallel to the B axis. And you can see that Y is going to be coinciding with that. And this makes an angle with respect to the C. And that is why this is going to be a monoclinic system. So okay, this is a clinopyroxene belongs to monoclinic system. I have not given an example of triclinic where you will be able to see that none of the indicatrix vibration directions are going to be parallel to the stereographic vibration direction. What is the difference between uniaxial and biaxial minerals? All anisotropic minerals contain one or two special directions that do not reorient light. That is the concept that we have seen. And in the case of uniaxial, we have seen that the section perpendicular to the c-axis is going to be circular. So minerals with one special direction are called uniaxial. In the case of biaxial, we can see that minerals with two special directions are called biaxial. So biaxial minerals belongs to orthorhombic, monoclinic, and triclinic, and we have seen that the refractive indices are represented as n alpha, n beta, and n gamma. Now, optic sign of a biaxial mineral. So you need to get some concept clear before we go to see the optic sign of a biaxial mineral. We can see that the major difference between uniaxial and biaxial are there are three principal indices in biaxial to be dealt with instead of two in uniaxial. So in uniaxial, this is going to be n epsilon and n omega. And in the case of biaxial, it's going to be n alpha, n beta, and n gamma. There are three principal sections through the indicatrix that are XY, XSH, and YSH. And the indicatrix has two circular sections with radius n beta that intersects in the y-axis. XSH plane contained both the optic axis and is called as the optic axial plane or OAP. So we'll see those things in this diagram. We can see that if this is a biaxial mineral, we can see this is Z axis, this is X axis, this is the XZ plane. So what you can see over here is this is the XZ plane. But if you take a section like this, this will contain both the optic axis, and that is going to be represented as N alpha and N gamma components will be there. If it's going to be N beta and N gamma, this is going to be a section which contain Y and Z. And in the case of a horizontal section, which contain XY plane, that is characterized by N alpha and N beta. But remember, all three, as it is having different refractive indices, are going to be an ellipse. Except these two directions between X and Z, we can see you will be having two sections with a radius of Y, which is characterized by N beta. Those are going to be a circular section. And those circular sections are characteristic because perpendicular to the circular section is the emergence of optic axis. So acute angle between the optic axis is the optic angle or 2V angle. The axis, either X or Z, bisects a 2V angle is the acute bisectrix or BXA. The axis, either X or Z, bisects the obtuse angle is the obtuse bisectrix. So remember these terms. In the previous slide, we have seen what are two circular sections, which is having radius of N beta. Perpendicular to the circular section is the emergence of optic axis. Optic axial plane is the plane which contain both the optic axis and optic axial plane in the case of biaxial mineral is the XZ plane. The acute angle between the optic axis is the optic angle or 2V angle. The acute bisectrix or BXA is when the 2V angle is bisects X or Z. Obtuse bisectrix is BXO when the angle is bisecting optic axis. Obtuse angle is actually bisecting the X or Z. Optic normal is the direction perpendicular to the optic axial plane. That is the y-axis vibration direction or n beta. We'll see that in the next diagram. Before that, have a look at this. The optic sign is defined based on whether the X or Z axis is the acute bisectrix. Okay, so that is a major concept we are going to learn from here. How are you going to see whether those axes bisects the 2V? That how to reach that in a thin section, that will help you to identify the optic sign in an actual experiment that we will see in the second part of the video. But in the first part, based on the indicatrix and this 2V angle, how are we going to see a mineral is optically positive or negative when it is biaxial? If the acute bisectrix, that is X, the mineral is optically negative. If the acute bisectrix is Z, the mineral is optically positive. That is the concept. In special case, where 2B is exactly 90, the mineral is optically neutral. Look at this diagram. So this is what we have seen as the indicatrix for biaxial, where you can see this is the XZ plane, where two optic axes are there. The angle between this is called as 2B. And if it is going to be acute, so this is going to be the acute bisectrix. If you take a section like this, this is going to be acute bisectrix section. And you can see that this 2V is bisecting Z. That is why it is being represented as 2VZ. That is why this is optically positive. Remember, at the same time, if somebody is telling if BXO, that is going to be this part, where you can see that BXO is going to be this, okay? That is bisecting X. Still, it is going to be optically positive. The biaxial positive, if BXO is going to be X or BXA is going to be Z, both are positive. So you can either go by BXA. So if BXA, acute bisectrix, is Z, then it is going to be positive. Acute bisectrix is going to be X. Look at this over here. This is the acute bisectrix. Okay, between this acute angle, X is bisecting. So BXO, BXA is X. That is why it is called as optically negative. At the same time, this is going to be the BXO, that is going to be Z. So that is the major concept that you're actually learning here. Let's summarize it once again. Biaxial optic sign is dependent on whether the X or Z indicatrix axis is the acute bisectrix. BXA is X, it is optically negative. BXA is Z, it's optically positive. This will give you a better picture where we can see that X axis is the 2VX angle and the Z axis is the 2VZ angle. And you can see that 2VX plus 2VZ is going to be 180. If 2VZ is going to be less than 90, that is going to be positive. 2VZ is going to be greater than 90, is going to be negative. And 2VZ is going to be 90, that mineral is going to be neutral. So we can see that 2V angle is 90, it's going to be neutral. Let's come to the biaxial interference figure. Biaxial interference figure is similar to the uniaxial one that we have seen in our previous video. It looked like same. But you can see that there's a isochromes, what you see over here. This will show you a pattern of 8, unlike the circular isochromes in the case of uniaxial membrane. That is the major difference. And when you rotate it, you can see that this isogear, which actually forms as a cross, will split and forms two hyperboles. And the center of that is going to be representing the emergence of the optic axis. So this is an optic biaxial acute bisectrix figure with two optic axes pointed over here. And these black lines are the isogear. And these lines, which is showing the pattern of 8, are called the isochromes. Let's see the parts of that. Isogear, we have seen this in the case of uniaxial mineral also, a band of extinction in an interference figure that appears where light vibration directions are parallel and perpendicular to the lower and upper polarizers. Melotope is the trace of the optic axis, or in the case of biaxial, that's going to be two optic axes. So we can see that that hyperboles come, and center of that is going to be the emergence of the optic axis of biaxial mineral. Isochromes, color bands which wrap around the optic axis or the optic axis in biaxial mineral, showing a different pattern than the uniaxial one, which you can compare over here, that a uniaxial interference figure will be having a cross which stays same even though when you rotate the slide. And you can see that the isochromes are characterized by this. Also remember the vibration directions of this is going to be fixed. We have seen the spokes of a wheel kind of vibration directions are the epsilon, and you will be seeing the orientation of omega perpendicular to that. But when you come to biaxial, this is how you will see that. When you rotate that, you can see that it splits and it forms two hyperboles, and center of those hyperboles indicating the melotopes. And the isochromes are not going to be circular like in the case of uniaxial. The isochromes are showing a pattern of 8 because of the influence of two optic axes. That is the major difference between the uniaxial interference figure and biaxial interference figure. I want to conclude with one more point over here. Focus into this particular part, vibration direction of biaxial mineral would be slightly different than the uniaxial that we have seen, as it has got three refractive indices, N alpha, N beta, and N gamma. Remember here, between the hyperboles or between the optic axis, this vibration direction that you see is the one which represents the obtuse bisectrix. Okay, I'll explain that like again. Between this, whatever the data that you're going to get, this is the vibration direction, is going to be represented as the obtuse one. And outside the hyperbole, what you're seeing is the representation of the vibration direction, which is coming between the 2V or acute bisectrix. Okay, so that is what we are going to see in the next one, where we can see how to reach the optic sign of a biaxial mineral based on these properties. I will end the session with the picture, the actual picture of how a biaxial mineral look like. So this is a isogear, isochromes, and this is the emergence of optic axis and uniaxial. In the case of this, when you rotate it, it actually splits and you have got two hyperboles. These are the isogears, and this is going to be the emergence of optic axis. If you draw a line connecting these two melatops, what are this going to be? This line, this is the representation of the optic axial plane. Okay, and perpendicular to that is going to be N beta. So I am ending the session with this figure, a comparison of uniaxial interference figure and biaxial interference figure. In the next session, we will see how we will able to reach the properties of biaxial mineral in different sections and identify how to read the optic sign of a biaxial mineral. Thank you.